First, I'd like to thank Great Small Works for coming up with something really amazing. In a minute, I'm going to contextualize it, but what was very interesting is all of the quotes and the story that you just heard are accurate. You sort of had a brief tale of the Zunimod and Yossel Cutler's lives in a very interesting way. In addition to thanking Great Small Works, I'd like to thank Helena Gindi for organizing this, and Leah. I'd like to thank the YIVO archivists for helping with the puppets. I would like to thank Nat Norbert for the puppets. I'd also like to thank David and Audrey Buchholz, who loaned us Zunimod's puppets, who are in the cases outside. You should look at them afterwards. They're really quite amazing. These are the original puppets that that Maud and Cutler used. And as Helena mentioned, when we started, Abe Rossman and Esther Horowitz, Zuni's relatives, are here. I should mention that the loaners of the donors of the loaners of the puppets of Zuni's puppets, the Buchholzes, are the son David Buchholz is the son of Nat Norbert, who was the last puppeteer to have worked with Zunimod, and he inherited Zunimod's puppets, which is why he had them. Now let me talk a bit about the history of Modicut. This was the creation of two artists and writers, Zunimod and Yossel Cutler. Zuni, as you know from the show, was born in Vashlakov, which is a shtetl near Bialystok. He was born in 1891. He came to the United States in 1905. When he got here, he worked as a cigar roller. He worked in a sweatshop sewing clothes. He worked as what's called a shikyingel, or an errand boy. That's where he got the name Zuni. His real name is Yitzchok. But when you're an errand boy, everyone calls you Sonny. But in Yiddish, Sonny is Zuni. And that name stuck, and he wound up with it for his entire life. During the day, he worked in these various professions. At night, he went to art school. He was someone who always loved to draw. And when he was a child in Cheder, he used to get in trouble for what he called illustrating Mishnayos, or drawing pictures of what he heard in class. These are the two, Zuni and Yossel. And as you also heard in the show, they really did create their name by putting their names together, Maud and Cutler. Now, when Zuni got connected with a group, a Yiddish literary group called the Junge. This is a group of poets and writers who were sort of revolting against the proletarian style of Yiddish literature and poetry, aiming for a more romantic style. Zuni sort of became their in-house illustrator and drew for their magazines and journals. He also was a cartoonist for Der Größer Kundis, which was a kind of Yiddish version of Mad Magazine. It had, but let's say, a much more politicized socialist version of Mad Magazine. And Zuni drew from them from the very beginning when it started in 1908 through its end in 1927. He had a number of forays into different magazines, newspapers, and journals. He created the comics page of the Jewish Daily Forward, of the Forwards. This is an example of it, where he drew five or six comics each Sunday. Some of them were related to life on the Lower East Side, traditional Jewish life, all kinds of things. This one very quickly has a person, a Jew from the Lower East Side, waiting in line. His name is Borach Itche. He has $15. Who should he play first? And he's got all these people lined up to pay. This very quickly is before. Oh, and incidentally, Yiddish cartoons go right to left. This is before the wedding, after the wedding, and a bit later. And you don't need to know Yiddish what's happening in this cartoon. This is another one of his cartoons. This one is particularly nice. It shows how technology changes Jewish life. Going right to left, you have a cantor. The caption says he's amazing. He's got a voice like a lion. He's incredible. After a few panels, the cantor begins to stutter, and then we see the shamus coming over and winding up the Victrola. So it's an interesting look into how technology changes things. One interesting aspect about Junior's cartoons is that he was very interested in multi-panel cartoons. The paradigm for Yiddish cartoons was single-panel, generally political cartoons, but Junior was very interested in quick, jokey narratives. And he did them in the Vorwärts, he did a few in Der Größer Kundis, and he did a very large number of them in a little-known daily called Die Zeit, which was a labor Zionist daily that was published from 1920 to 22. And he created a character named Charlie Smachste, who was very much, which sort of means, Charlie, how you doing? And it was very much based on himself. It was about a guy who didn't want to work. He nonetheless did a lot of political cartoons, and this is just one example. He also was instrumental in creating a wide variety of different illustrations for different newspapers. By 1922, he was already associated with the Morgen Freiheit, the Yiddish communist newspaper. This is an illustration he did for them. But one other thing that he did is he produced a very large number of illustrations for books, for Yiddish books. This is just one of them. This is another. This is his portrait of Yossel Kotler. Now, Yossel Kotler, let me move on to him. He was born in 1895 in Troinets in Ukraine, came to the United States in 1911. He worked as a sign painter. He eventually got involved in it with a small literary group and became a protege of Moshe Nadir, who's a well-known Yiddish satirist. To show a few of, he also worked in Der Größer Kundis. This is where he met Zuni Maud. He produced a very large number of cartoons and stories for both the Kundis and the Morgen Freiheit. Many of them were very anti-religious, as perhaps is this one. Something else that both Kotler and Maud did, they were both very instrumental in creating artistic Yiddish books. This is Kotler's title page and one of the illustrations he did for Moshe Leib Halpern's Golden Apave, The Golden Peacock, which is a book of poetry. There's another illustration Kotler did for a book called, an anthology called Yiddish America. Here's a drawing that Zuni Maud did for Avram Dillon's Gele Blätter, Yellow Leaves. And the entire book was has Maud's orthography and drawings, and they're quite haunting and really quite creative and original. They also did a lot of magazine covers. This is Kotler's cover of Der Hammer. This is an illustration from Kotler's own book, Muntergang. This is an illustration from the story Affenstern Mars, on the planet Mars, which is one of the first Yiddish science fiction stories. And as I said, they opened a studio together after meeting in Der Kundis in 1922, 1923. And whenever they did work together, they signed their name Modicut. This is a Yiddish theater poster they did. And you can see the inset, how they signed Modicut. This means they worked on the poster together. Now, in 1925, Yiddish theater director Mori Schwartz asked them to create a puppet scene for the Kishifmacherin, the witch, that a play that he was working on, and with something that they did, but the puppets were too small to be seen from the theater, so he told them to forget it. They took their puppets home, they crafted two Jewish characters, and they began to take their puppets around to the cafes they frequented, to the parties they went to, and they did shtick with their puppets. And their friends loved it. They said, you know what, you really have to create a Yiddish puppet theater. So they did. At the end of 1925, they rented a second floor, what had been a children's clothing factory on the second floor of a building on 12th Street and 2nd Avenue, and started their theater. They played about 8 shows a week. It became incredibly popular. The first shows they did were a Purim spiel called Achashverosh, and a version of the Dybbuk, a parody of the Dybbuk, where the woman who's the or the girl who's the star, Leia, she lives on Delancey Street, and all of the she is inhabited by a Dybbuk, and all of the rabbis that come to take the Dybbuk out are directors of the various theaters that are showing the Dybbuk that season. They also, something very interesting happened during that time. This is just a program that from 1927. When they were in that space on 12th Street, their landlord wanted to kick them out and took them to court. They didn't hire a lawyer. Instead, they showed up in court with their puppets and had their puppets plead their case. Now, the landlord rightly claimed that the space was not zoned to be a theater, which is what they were using it for, and he was in his legal rights to evict them. But the judge apparently was so taken by the puppets, he said to Martin Cutler, you know, you don't have to have a theater, but you could have a private club. And if you sell memberships or as tickets to the club, you can continue playing there, which is what they did, much to the chagrin of the landlord. Now, in 1927 and 28, they toured the U.S. and Canada. In 1929 and 30, they traveled to France, Belgium, and Poland to huge success, especially in Poland. In Warsaw, they played 200 sold-out shows at the Warsaw Literary Union. In Vilna, they played 75 sold-out shows. They were an enormous hit there. Their success there was quite incredible. And one of the interesting aspects was that the reviews, the writers, the literary people with whom they were connected in Warsaw were so amazed that something so truly Yiddishlich, something so deeply Jewish could come from, of all places, America. And Maud and Cutler were considered by them to be Americans. That's how they saw them. In one of the quotes that I'll read, and what's funny is that Jenny, during the show, read some actual quotes of reviews from the Warsaw shows. One of them was written by Nachman Meisel, who was a major literary critic, who wrote for Literarische Blätter, which was the leading Yiddish literary magazine in Warsaw. And he said, the entire program is full of extraordinary folk humor, wonderful ideas, and splendid technique. We have here truly Jewish wrinkles and gestures, words and mumbles, sighs and groans, all of which come from Jewish sources and a Jewish way of life. Now, as Jenny and Great Small Works noted, Maud and Cutler were sort of opposites that attracted. Incidentally, this is the membership card from the theater that you bought when you, instead of buying a ticket. The difference between Maud and Cutler were incredible. As they said, Maud was short, Cutler was tall. And the quote they read was from Melech Ravitch. Melech Ravitch was a poet and writer who was the secretary of the Warsaw Literary Union. And he said, truly, if anyone who ever doubted that a pair is prearranged in heaven, he should take a look at Zuni Maud and Yossel Cutler. Such an artistic duo, each complementing the other so wonderfully, is truly a rarity in this world. Maud is short. Cutler is tall. Maud has a deep bass, a murky, dark bass. Cutler has a bright, cheeky, boyish tenor. Maud is full of Jewish folkloric tradition. Cutler is an expressionist, but when they're together, there's no contrast whatsoever. Neuer Steinberg, a writer and poet in America, wrote very similarly. Cutler is the opposite of Maud. Maud is difficult. Cutler is easy. Maud is stubborn. Cutler, acquiescent. Maud is brutally critical. Cutler, naive and mild. The Yiddish poet Zisho Weinper also commented on how different their personalities were, writing that their work together created a kind of harmony which brought them to their artistic goal. He further stated that they were the only artists who brought an element of fun into the left-wing proletarian movement. If you've ever heard of boring from within, they were the opposite of that. Now, in 1931 and 32, Maud and Cutler toured the Soviet Union, where they received great acclaim. In fact, they were asked to head a special Yiddish puppet and stage section. And they were there for about, they stayed for about 6 months, but eventually went back to New York. This is a photograph from the Warsaw Literary Union, where Modern Cutler, who are in the center, are surrounded by a number of the writers. This is from their tour of the Soviet Union, holding some of their puppets. As they continued their theater, it became much more politicized, and the puppets in this image you could see on the left is Gandhi. Next to him is Ramsay MacDonald, who's the Prime Minister of England. In the center is Leon Blum, who was the Prime Minister of France. And on the far right is Herbert Hoover, who, if you turned his head around, it was a rotten apple. They also played frequently, and every summer, they were the in-house entertainment at Maud Zumarai. Zuni's family ran a resort in North Branch, a summer resort in North Branch, New York, that was also a center for the intellectual left. And Modern Cutler performed there every summer, ran the entertainment, and I was told that the only thing under lock and key in the resort was Zuni and Yossel's puppets. Now, just a couple of pictures. This is one of the murals they painted in the dining hall of Maud Zumarai. And this is, they're sitting below it. This is also one of their murals of a man getting serviced. Now, unfortunately, in 1933, they broke up their little troupe. There was apparently some argument, the source of which is unknown. They each went out on their own to perform puppetry with various partners. In 1935, Yossel Cutler took a trip to California performing in cities along the way. He'd intended on creating a full-length Yiddish puppet film. Unfortunately, he was killed in Iowa by a drunk driver on the way. His body was brought back to New York in June of 1935. Allegedly 15,000 people attended his funeral, which is really a testament to just how popular they were. Zuni Maud continued to perform puppetry and to write and to create art until he passed away in 1956. All that's evident here is that the incredible creativity of this duo, their art, their satire, is just one example of the broad range of what was possible in Yiddish culture. Now, very quickly, and this is interesting because you just saw a modern version of it. And one of the great things about great small works in recreating these modicut works is they are taking the past and making it useful. They're taking archival materials and doing something that no one else has done with them. Everything you've seen and heard is based on archival research that inspired them. Sorry, I don't know how to stop this. I'm just going to let it play. Yossel Cutler made this in 1935. And this is thanks to the National Center for Jewish Film in Brandeis, who owns the film.
Und wie das ist Jatlach? Das ist ein kleiner Teil von der ersten jüdischen Marinettlach in der Gura-Welt. Sie nehmen einen gewaltigen... Los, du ist reden ein Wort. Sehen wir, los, du ist reden ein Wort. Sie nehmen einen gewaltigen Anteil, der masieren die jüdische Masse in New York. Was willst du? Was willst du nicht reden ein Wort? Ja, das liegt schon nicht da. Jetzt fuhren sie über ein Land. West, bis Hollywood, bis mehr Westafrika, wer weiß. Paar Schindler sind sie Gringe, in kein Essen munnen sie nicht, sie sind ständig gräbt. Du schaust dir früher nicht gesucht, Gaselwing, komm und mir gehen.
Ich bin der Chairman von der Marinette. Und ich hab dem größten Kuhwitz mit dem gewaltigen Fahrgenügen auch vorzustellen, kein anderer wie Semche mit Sanidene. Thank you.
Was ihr öfter gesehen, mein Niedene Haar? Nicht gesehen. Wenn man bedarf, sie ist in der Stube. Einmal, ob sie nicht bedarf, ist sie ja gekommen. Schöne Pässe, wie bist du? Schöne Pässe. Schöne Pässe, Vera. Wie ist schöne Pässe?
Ha?
Wo sporst du so durch den Kitchen? Die Alten muss sie kochen, wenn man bluffst. Du noch schöne Pässe, die weiß. Du gewinnst der Ländler.
Oi, ihr Dunner ist mir.
Schau, Dunner nicht. Er hat mir gebracht, aber tun auf Schabbes.
Wo?
Ah, das Verdus.
Was ist das?
Das ist ein Sadus. Das ist ein waftiger Reus von der Brunnen.
Oi, wei ist mir, ein Wind ist mir. Oi, 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 oi.
Er ist weiken. Er ruft, ob Tante mir eine Wege. Steh an Stil, ob Tante mir Wege. Was ist das mit dir, was? Ich weiß, wo die das tun. Die Schen zieht zum Unemployment Council.
Was ist das für ein Council, hä?
Das ist ein Sack-Council. Das heißt, der Ländler wacht da ruhig. Warf doch Council rein. Nun geh, mein teure schöne Pferd. Deis! Von der gestellten Kiste mit drinnen. Ha, ha, ha. Eis, ja, teure Idenmaschine, Pessi. Wo sich die, helft sie mir heraus. Bin ich Presser, helft sie mir pressen. Bin ich hingereg, helft sie mir essen. I'm telling you, she's marvel, Tanek, she's marvel. Efter wollt ihr wissen. Ja, so in mir haben sich beide verliebt, ha? So, schämt sich nicht, ihr wollt wissen. Kein Stagefieber darf ihr nicht stuben. Ihr bin doch auf der Bühne auf dem Stage. Okay. Ich bin mir gesessen, also in Esterpark. In gesingen ein Liedele. Die Liebe, die hat mich arim gestompe weg. Azoi abone der Dus fast. Haha. Was ist er bald verliebt in mir? Früher hat er verliebt in meine Stimme. Nur hat er verliebt in mein Euer. Dem Euer. Nur in dem Euer. Nur hat er verliebt in mein Nuss. Und also ist er verliebt in verliebt, wieso ist er verliebt in alle meine Kleinigkeiten. Im Nistertor leben mir doch Gott zu danken, beschulen. I'm telling you, she's marvelous, honestly, she's marvelous. Schau, jetzt kommen sie schon zum Konsul. Schöne Pässe. Wo haben sie gesucht, ha?
Gesucht? Okay.
Das ist gut. Ich bin ein bisschen schläferig, schöne Pässe.
Ja?
Ich sag, vielleicht, ich hab mal drin. Ich will sehen, also kratz mich. Ist noch weg, ha?
Ja. Ja.
Gut. Ich hab doch mir noch nicht gekratzt, muss weg, du mir schon auf. Doch kratzt ist doch wohl weg. Aber schon gekratzt.
Ja.
Ich hätte so eine Memme, ich weiß nicht, wo es früher war zu dem Ländler. Zu fahr der Ruhm, zu fahr der Wand. Nur über so darf man tanzen. Ihr Ich hab mir gearbeitet bei Schlösser verschiedene. Gewinn als auch Arbeit, hat mir geholfen, man jeden Ehren.
What was amazing about Great Small Works' variation on that is that was the first time in about 80 years that puppet play has been performed. So that's really pretty incredible. Now I'd like to bring up Professor John Bell, who will talk a bit about puppetry in New York. Professor Bell.
I wanted to thank Eddy, who's made such. Here it is, right here. I usually use a Mac, and this is a PC, so I might. Oh my God, what am I going to do? Eddy made such a great contribution to the history of American puppetry by writing an article about. Modicut that appeared first in the Drama Review and then in a book called Puppets, Masks, and Performing Objects, and it's a wonderful piece of history writing, and I deeply appreciate it. I wanted to talk about the contexts in which Zuni, Maud, and Yossel Cutler created puppet theater in the 1920s and 30s in New York City, which was a time of great fecundity, innovation, and modern spirit in the puppetry arts. A lot of that happened in Europe, but in the United States, things were a little bit different. A couple of things I wanted to mention were that, as you saw in the video that Eddy showed, some of the big stylistic innovations that Modicut did were to create mouths that opened and closed, and eyes, and ears. And this was pretty new to the scene of American puppetry. Hand puppets especially are street performers. Hand puppets are direct. Hand puppets are used to convey ideas in a very succinct way to audiences. Marionettes, the string puppets operated from above, are much more high class and artistic. So by choosing hand puppets, Zuni and Yossel were able to deal with the kind of ideas, the kind of traditions of puppet theater that, that affect people directly and that have a real political content. Okay. We mentioned in our show that Yossel had seen Russian Petrushka hand puppet theater in the shtetl where he grew up, which is one of the great traditions of European puppet theater. Each different country in Europe has its own particular tradition, and Petrushka is the tradition in Russia. So they came to the States with some of that, at least with Yossel, some sense of the European puppet forms. In the United States, hand puppets had been particularly popular from the actually late 1700s through the 19th century. These puppets are by the Lano family, an Italian family who was active in the United States. They played during the 1860s, during the Civil War. They would go to armed encampments on both sides of the war and perform Punch and Judy shows. So Punch and Judy was a very popular form of puppet theater. You can see here the circus sideshow somewhere in the United States with a hand puppet booth in the lower left-hand corner there. That was one way that puppets were very much involved with American culture in circuses and dime museums. For example, Barnum's Dime Museum here in New York City. Tony Sarg is often credited with being the first puppeteer in the United States, by which I think the biographer who wrote that meant the first kind of formal European style art theater or pretensions of art theater in the US. As I said, there were hundreds of puppeteers doing hand puppet shows on the streets and in different places for an entire 100 years before that. And of course, indigenous folks, First Nations people, have always used puppets, masks, and performing objects in ritual performances that are some of the richest work in the American continent. But Sarg, of German origin, actually born in Guatemala, copied the techniques of English marionette performers and let me try something like that. Good. And became quite famous in the United States in New York City in the teens, 20s, and 30s, doing marionette shows that were very popular. He created touring companies that toured around the United States and trained some of the famous puppeteers to come, like Bill Baird and Rufus and Margot Jones. He did Alice in Wonderland here in 1932. Also, like Yossel and Zuni, he was a graphic designer, a great graphic artist. Many puppeteers are. And he did advertising displays for Macy's department store. And when they wanted to do a giant parade in New York City to get people to come to buy stuff in the store at Christmas time, he designed the inflatable puppets, which is really a pretty unique American contribution to American puppetry in the early 20th century. This is an example of his graphic work. He was also a prolific writer. His Tony Sarg marionette book was another popular aspect of puppetry in the U.S. The Little Theater Movement, which brought art theater to the United States. Before the Little Theater Movement, there was a feeling in the theater community that, well, we have commercial theater, we have the Broadway shows, we have minstrel shows, we have melodrama. We don't really have art theater like the Europeans do. And the Little Theater Movement, which among other playwrights created Eugene O'Neill, was an effort to create art theater. And puppets were a very important part of that art theater. And different types of abstract art, theater art, and visual art. Ralph Chessay, a puppeteer from San Francisco, came to the U.S., worked in the neighborhood playhouse with Tony Sarg, and then did his own version of Eugene O'Neill's The Emperor Jones, which was a pretty signal moment in American theater history because the play deals with race and psychology. The puppeteer Remo Bufano grew up on the Lower East Side, not far from where Yossel and Zuni worked in an Italian community, and there was a very popular form of Sicilian marionette theater in New York City at the time. The Manteo family was probably the only one of those families left. They did storefront shows in downtown New York and in Brooklyn. I think there were at most three or four companies doing Sicilian marionette theater, epic 300-episode epics of stories about Orlando Furioso. But Bufano, and this is Bufano right here, also worked with the Provincetown Playhouse, so he got in touch with the avant-garde movement of the time. And Jack Twerkoff, who worked with Bufano, and then for an important early amount of time worked with Zuni and Yossel and helped them with puppet design. So Twerkoff working with Bufano was part of the little theater movement, puppetry stuff, and then worked with Modicut. Modicut was a very interesting aspect of this. Bufano, this is just interesting in a way, a Purimspiel that Bufano did in the 1920s, in addition to making giant masks for a 1932 production of Alice in Wonderland. Yes, and he did an opera at the Metropolitan Opera House, Igor Stravinsky's Oedipus Rex at the Metropolitan Opera in 1931. Sometimes we think that opera and puppets arrives with Julie Taymor doing the Magic Flute, or opera and Broadway arrives with The Lion King, but there were these very interesting examples earlier. This is a giant puppet head he made for the 1939 World's Fair. He also was the head of the Federal Theater Project's puppet unit in New York City, which was the most successful Federal Theater Project unit in the city, more successful than the acting Federal Theater Project units. I was interested in activist theater and political theater at the time and their use of giant puppets. This is Moses Sawyer with a street demonstration banner with the Artists Union, a photograph by Ben Shahn, and a giant puppet in a 1930s demonstration, again by Ben Shahn, of a capitalist or we don't know who. And these are hand puppeteers in a May Day parade in 1936. Joseph Albach, so this is the Communist May Day Parade. There was also a Socialist May Day Parade, and they had two different parades, but puppets were an important part of that. I don't know if Zuni and Yossel were involved in making puppets for May Day parades. Here's backpack puppets from, this is in Union Square. And also in the 30s, David Siqueiros, the radical Mexican visual artist, had a workshop in Union Square and making political art, which included giant floats with puppets like this one here for the Communist Party. And young Jackson Pollock and his brother spent the summer working with David Siqueiros and got involved with making these giant puppets in New York in the 30s. This is Jackson Pollock working on the giant puppet piece for the May Day Parade in 1936. So that's a very short attempt to give you a sense of context and the world in which Zuni and Yossel created their hand puppet theater. In thinking of all these things together, I'm reminded, because of Eddie's article and the research he's done, what an incredibly unique effort Zuni and Yossel made in creating this Yiddish modernist American puppet theater that was political puppet theater, that was entertaining, that made had a great effect on those who watched it. So we're really happy that we could be part of this rethinking about Zuni and Yossel.